This is the Average to Savage podcast with Paul Guarino. Everyone and anyone, athletes, celebs, and much more.
What's up, everybody? I'm back for another episode of Average to Savage podcast. Got another special guest, sports anchor, currently with the NFL Network, Cole Wright. Cole, what's up?
Hey, Paul, what's going on, man? Glad to be on the show.
Yeah, appreciate you coming on.
Anytime, man, anytime.
So let's just jump right into it. So could you give us a brief background about yourself?
Well, you know, it's funny because, you know, I obviously cover the NFL, but, you know, I have a pretty deep baseball background. You know, I played baseball in high school and college. I played a little independent professional baseball after college. And, you know, it was pretty much baseball that allowed me to be able to do what I do now. You know, and then, mm-hmm. you know, after college, I moved downtown to Chicago, waited tables, and kind of sent out resume tapes. And it took about almost, you know, a little bit over a year for me to finally get that first job, and I did, and it was San Angelo, Texas, and I bounced from Texas spot to Baton Rouge to working in Boston, and then at ESPN, and then Fox Sports 1, and, you know, now I feel like I found my home in NFL Network.
Yeah, definitely quite the journey right there.
Absolutely. No, and yeah, I mean, I've lived in, you know, counting college and all the jobs I've had, I've lived in 9 states. It's like, when I sat and realized that, I'm like, 9 states, like, that's a lot of different real estate to see, man. So, you know, it's, whenever I have someone that works on a show with me that's new or, you know, I haven't met them before, I always like to say, hey, where are you from? Where'd you go to school? Yeah. And when I was in Bristol, people used to be like, you say that to every single kid that walks in here or anyone that you just meet. And I'm like, well, that you can find a common thread.
Yeah.
Like, having lived in 9 states, I mean, I could have lived in one of the states that they lived in. You know, there's roughly a 20% chance I could have lived where they've lived before. Or maybe I went to 4 different schools, so maybe there's a chance that, you know, I know someone who went to school where they went to school. Or it just makes the conversation easier from the very, very beginning, so.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think that's a common question, too, but
right?
I don't know.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Could you tell us what your daily routine is when you're going to go on air that day?
You know, let's take a Sunday, for instance. You know, Sundays, I do game day highlights. This year, I do with Chris Rose and myself. It used to be Steve Mariucci and me, but, you know, Steve moves on a little bit of rest. He gets up and does that morning show, so he has to, you know, have some downtime so he's not, you know, burning the midnight oil every day. But, you know, the routine is, you know, I get there right around 9:30. All the games start at 10. You know, I pretty much, I have an old school composition book that I write all the games in. And as the game goes on, I take notes, who scored, you know, who caused this turnover, who did this, who did that. If, you know, I'll check the box scores too, if, you know, if there's a play that I missed, because, you know, you're watching, like, say, this Sunday, there's 9 games at once.
Yeah.
You can't, I mean, I've only got 2 eyes. I can't watch 9 games. So, you know, some games are going to get away from me at first, second, and then you just, you let everything filter back in. And then, you know, you grab some food and, you know, let a little more of the game sink in. And then I go back and I watch the first set of highlights once the early pack of games is done with. Because, you know, we're going to be on the air in an hour or two, and, you know, want to make sure you've laid a set of eyes on some of those highlights. And then after that, you know, I get dressed, go on set, and, you know, we really need to be in tune with our producer. My producer, Jason Brooksby, on the Sunday and Monday night, for that matter, the postgame show, he's my eyes and ears. Like, you know, you know where you're going. As long as your producer's in your ear, like, sure. You know, sometimes a lot of shows have scripted rundowns. I mean, we do, but it's loosely based because the late games, sometimes they might not be over with. And once they're getting done with, boom, they both send us a highlight, and then the show could go left when we thought it was going to go right. So the preparation is pretty much the same. It's, you know, just keep your eyes and your ears, you know, peeled on the games. Make sure you know what you're talking about and you stay in touch with your producer and your researcher.
Yeah, for sure. So how did you pick to become a sports anchor as your career?
It kind of was a result of failure. I mean, I guess I failed at being a professional baseball player. So that's what led me to wanting to stay somewhat close to the game.
Yep.
You know, I said to myself, you know, if I'm not going to be, you know, it was always what, you know, on the back burner, it's always what I thought I wanted to do. But once I got released from playing baseball, it was, well, what do I do now? And, you know, I had some interviews to sell pharmaceuticals, and I was like, this doesn't sound fun at all. Like, you mean, and my mom runs a veterinary hospital, and she has for almost 30 years, so I would have probably sold pet meds. So I would have been driving around the Chicagoland area, walking into different veterinary offices, trying to sell them, you know, amoxicillin, you know, for whatever. and didn't get that job. And it's probably better that it's maybe two instances of failure. I didn't make it as a baseball player, and no one hired me as a pharmaceutical rep. So I started sending my tape out from college. I didn't work extremely hard on, because you only had so many times to make a tape in college. Mm-hmm. But then I was lucky enough to get paired with my mentor at NBC in Chicago, Art Norman, and he was able to get a resume tape reshot for me, which ended up being terrific. I went to the NABJ Unity Conference in 2004 in Washington D.C. and a week later, I had a job offer. They told me that I got home on Sunday. They called me on Tuesday. They said, "We've got a job for you as a weekend sports anchor." And they told me how much I'd be making, which was, you needed a magnifying glass to see it on the paper. And by that time, they said, "If you can be here by Wednesday, the job is yours. If not, we'll give it to somebody else." So I don't know if they were bluffing or what, but I took the job. I waited tables every day until then, and got packed everything I could fit in my Jeep Cherokee and drove down to Texas 23 hours.
Yeah, that's wild.
Yeah, so, it happened super fast, man.
So did you go to school for communications?
I did. I got my degree from Briarcliff University. It's NAIA school in mm-hmm. Sioux City, Iowa. And they have a great communications department. And when I was there, they opened up their brand new integrated multimedia lab. They call it the IML. And we were literally 5 minutes away at that point in time from Gateway Computers. And you might be too young, Paul, to know about Gateway Computers, but they were huge back in the day. And we had, and when I graduated from college in 2002, we had the double flat screen computer panels. And it was, you could drag from one screen to the next. And that was kind of cutting edge, especially for linear editing, to be able to have a two panel computer and to be able to edit across from computer to computer. So we had a pretty high tech, IML, and actually Creighton, they modeled their media lab after ours. So it ended up working out as far as, the degree and the communications and everything I was able to put to work after school. So, I'm pretty thankful, and maybe not in the moment. When you're in school, it's like you don't really pay attention to things. Yeah. But once you get a little bit past, you realize, the gifts that you were given.
Yeah, for sure. So yeah, you were doing that while you were playing baseball, obviously. So when did you know, while in college? I guess you said you kind of briefly touched on it, but so was that your backup plan to become an anchor?
Well, I don't know if it was any plan. I still kind of thought I was going to maybe get picked up throwing, and I was always, working out and still throwing. But, you want to know what really made me say, man, I need to get a job. One day, my buddy, if you ever get down to Wrigley Field, my buddy owns Smoke Daddy right across from Wrigley Field, and he has a bunch of other restaurants. He was in my wedding. He was my manager when I worked downtown Chicago. I waited tables at Bandera, which is a Houston's restaurant. So we used to hang out. We weren't at work. My roommate, who runs Kevin Euclid's brew house up in Los Gatos, he was working. So my buddy that owns the restaurant, Josh, he called me. He's like, "Hey, man, you want to go grab some dinner?" I'm like, "All right, cool." So there's a place right down the street in Lincoln Park that had they had a burger and beer deal. So he picked me up. I saw this on our street where my car was parked. There was a sign that said, "Construction, please, move cars or else they will be towed." And it was a construction sign from the day before. So I looked at it. I'm like, no, they're not going to tell anybody. This is already past due. We go have dinner, come back. I still see it, just still pay no attention to it. I'm like, I'll move the car, never mind. I end up not moving it. Go to bed, wake up. My roommate asked me, "Hey, man, you give me a ride to work today?" Because I was driving out to the suburbs. Go downstairs to give him a ride to work, and they put a boot was on my car because I had a bunch of parking tickets. And I was like, I got to get a job here and start taking things serious, because I'm going to need to get this boot off of this car. And I got about 25 tickets, which, if you do the math, see, that's a cool $2,500 to get this boot off. Yeah. And I went to a place called Screens, because I didn't have a computer back then. I went to Screens and used the public computer and the public domain and sent everything out and got in touch with Art Norman at NBC. Long story short, I was in Washington D.C. for that first job conference, and a week after that, I had a job. So, like I said, things happened pretty quick that summer, and it all started with getting a boot on my car. My Nissan Stanza.
I love it. Yeah. So actually, that's what's crazy about today, because people don't think about it, and that's why people always say to me how are you doing all this stuff? I'm just we have technology. And you're talking about you got to go to the library to go apply for a job.
Right. Exactly. That's pretty much what it was.
That's why it's funny. But yeah.
It, it, things, though. It's like, I feel like guys that are my age, we appreciate Google more than a 20-year-old, because when we Google stuff, we remember it. Like, 20-year-olds know that Google's going to be there again. Like, I'll just go ask the same question again, and I'll just forget it in 5 minutes.
For sure. Oh, yeah, and by the way, I did have a Gateway computer. That was, like, the first computer I had.
Right? They had that kid with the Gateway commercials. Yeah, the Gateway was big back in the day, man. What happened to Gateway?
I don't know. Probably got bought out or something.
Yeah, probably.
So, I know you briefly touched on it at the beginning. So, could you give us more detail on your journey from local stations to regional stations to now national stations?
Well, like I said, I started in Texas and then another job in Texas, which was great because I actually got to cover, I mean, shoot, guys that are in the NFL now. I mean, I covered Ryan Tannehill when he was in high school. I covered, you know, Colt McCoy, Case Keenum. Like, these guys were the Friday night football games when I was at my very first job, which is nuts.
Yeah, it's awesome.
To see Case Keenum now is, you know, he was as good as he was last year on the Vikings, and to see him on the Broncos this year, you know, I wish nothing but the best for that cat. And it's like, going from there, I went to Tyler, Texas, and then I covered guys like Ryan Mallett and G.J. Kinney and Denarius Moore, like all these guys that had at one point or another made their way to the National Football League, or, you know, at least the top flight NCAA ranks. So when I was done there, you know, it's funny because at my first job, in the middle of a day, like I even when I first got there, I'd still send tapes out. Like I thought I was way better than what I really was.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to get out of my first job. Like, I mean, I legit sent out a resume tape to go somewhere else after like a month and a half. So my second job in Tyler, one day they called the newsroom and asked to speak to me because they saw my tape. And, you know, another job calls your job asking for you. And I'm in the newsroom and they're sitting there talking, asking, well, how much money do you make? We want to give you this job. I'm like, hey, can I call you back? I kind of have coworkers everywhere around me. So I went out in the parking lot. That's what everyone called their office, and got on the phone call. And, you know, they pretty much lured me away within a day. I was like, if you come work here, you'll be able to do this, that, and the other. And I was like, you know what, that sounds terrific. And that's what I did. I went and worked in Tyler. And from Tyler, the station, that the parent company that owned the station there opened up a brand new station in Baton Rouge. And, you know, my station's general manager said, hey, you know, we'd like you to be our sports director. And for me, the opportunity to cover LSU and the Saints and the Hornets at that point, it was before they, you know, were the Pelicans, you know, that was a dream come true. I mean, you love sports. You want to cover sports at the highest level. You want to cover, you know, professional and top flight, you know, college, SEC. Why not? And that's what I was able to do. And it seemed like it was just a string of good luck because, I mean, the Saints went to the NFC Championship game. The LSU baseball team went to the College World Series. The women's basketball team went to Final Four after Final Four. And the Hornets went to the Western Conference Semis versus the Spurs. So, you know, my resume tape looked like, you know, it was unbelievable. I was, you know, it was a perfect storm where all these things were able to come together, and I was able to put it on my tape. And, you know, from there, like I said, I went to the other Unity conference that was in Chicago, and I got a job at Nesson. You know, so from Baton Rouge to Boston, you know, it was 2 years in Boston, and after that, just took a short trip up the road to Connecticut. I mean, you know all about the I-95 corridor, Paul. And, you know, I used to live in New London, and then before that, I lived in North Attleboro. So from North Attleboro to New London, because my wife worked in Providence, so I was driving 61 miles from New London to Bristol every day. And then my wife got a job at ESPN, so we lived 61 miles away for nothing.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy how things, especially how quickly things unfold, and you never know.
Yeah, actually, at my current job, that's my office too, the parking lot. That's where I get all my stuff. Then I go outside to call people.
Nice. Exactly.
So I know you worked at ESPN and Fox Sports 1. So what was like the differences between those two networks? And I believe you were there at Fox Sports 1 like right when they started, right?
I was. Yeah. I was. Yeah, when they had the traditional model, you know, they had Fox Sports Live, you know, your traditional highlight show. Yeah. I think the biggest difference is there's way less personnel at Fox. I mean, obviously, you know, ESPN is a machine.
Yeah.
But there's just so many different people that work on so many different shows. Even if it's the same show from day to day, there could be a whole different cast. Yeah. And that's one of the things that sometimes is, you know, it's just navigating the water. Some people are excellent at it. Other people are, you know, not so much. And, you know, it just that maybe it didn't seem like it was the 100% place for me, even though it is the it's the worldwide leader in sports. Mm-hmm. But sometimes it's just not always the best marriage, the best chemistry. And I feel like, you know, when I went to Fox, it was a little bit smaller. Even though it was still a large national entity. Yeah. It's just, like I said, not as many cooks in the kitchen.
Yeah.
And NFL Network, that's the one thing. The one thing about NFL Network to me is that we always call ourselves the NFL Network family.
Mm-hmm.
Like, whether it be in summits or meetings or memos. But it really is true. Like, I really do feel that way. Like, you know everybody that works there. You know, you see people, whether it's you're at the draft or the combine or, you know, the owner meetings. Like, the camera people, whether they're coming from New York or whether they're people that they hire just for the event, they're all just good people. Not to say people anywhere else aren't, but I feel like when you work with a close-knit bunch, everyone is in it together. Like, everyone wants to make sure they pull their own weight for the next guy. Or, when this person is working on that, you know, they'll make sure they go above and beyond. And I just feel like that's the complete definition of a team effort. And a family, and that's what we have at NFL Network. I truly believe that.
Yeah, that's awesome. And working at NFL Network, what's it like working with, like, former NFL stars?
You know, it's cool because they're all different personalities.
Yeah.
You know, there's going to be your guys who talk a lot. There's going to be guys that just walk in the room and you say hey, and they keep it moving, and you know they're very, you know, personal and to themselves.
Yeah.
You know, everyone, we all have our favorites. I mean, I'm biased. I worked with him every morning for, you know, close to a year. But Terrell Davis, yeah, that's my guy, man. He's the luckiest golfer in America. So if anyone ever gets an invite from TD to go golfing, I politely decline if I were you guys, unless you're a single digit handicap, because he's gonna hit a ball off of a crow's nest that's gonna, you know, roll down a tree branch and, you know, maybe stick on a dove's beak, and the dove's gonna end up flying into the hole, and just like that, you know, he's got an eagle. I'm like, how did that happen? So, but yeah, there's a bunch, like I said, a bunch of different guys up there, you know, and there's so many different players that, you know, whether they were a Hall of Famer or, you know, a ham and egger, there's so many different guys who bring so much to the table and to the conversation. And, you know, being a baseball guy, you know, I feel like I can legitimately learn things from them. You know, I played football a little bit back in the day, but not at a high level as any of these cats. So I feel like when I ask questions and I want to know things, when we're doing a post-game show or we're in the middle of a highlight or something like that, I feel like I'm legitimately asking these questions that the people want to know, because the layman doesn't always know all these things. And I feel like when you can bring that to the forefront and flush that out, as opposed to being the guy who knows all the questions and knows the questions and you know what they're going to say, I feel like when you come from a point somewhat ignorance, you know, I feel like that really fuels a discussion. Like, if I ask a guy, well, why this as opposed to this, they're going to give you their genuine answer. And I feel like that's one of the best things with so many different personalities, whether it be a Hall of Famer, you know, or a guy who played just a little bit in the league. I mean, you're going to get a wide spectrum when it comes to all these cats.
Yeah, for sure. That's pretty dope. But
absolutely.
Yeah. So what's your take on the players taking a knee for the national anthem?
You know, I mean, I feel like the whole genesis of it was to boycott, you know, unlawful treatment. It's the myth that's being perpetuated that these players are against the military. I mean, that couldn't be further from the truth. Yeah. I mean, you know, obviously Colin Kaepernick was instructed by Nate Boyer, a former Green Beret, that, you know, to kneel as a form of respect. And I don't think any disrespect has been shown. I just, it's funny how, you know, sometimes people will say, you know, look at the disrespect that's shown. But I mean, it's these people, some of the people that cast the first stone, you know, they haven't really done a whole bunch to help these troops that they say are being so highly disrespected. So, you know, it's a slippery slope. And, you know, I've had people ask me before, like, what are you guys going to do at NFL Network about the anthem and Colin Kaepernick? Well, last time I looked, we at NFL Network aren't in the business of showing the national anthem in highlight packages. I mean, when have you ever seen that? Like, all right, let's check out Broncos Raiders. The national anthem was real hot to jump this game off. You never see that.
Yeah.
So we're not in the business of showing the national anthem in general. And second of all, we're not in the business of putting players out there or reporting on players who are not in the National Football League. And unfortunately, Colin Kaepernick, no longer a member of the National Football League, so we don't really report on him. And that's pretty much where it's at. I mean, could he still play in the National Football League? Absolutely. Will he? That's yet to be determined. It doesn't look like we're going down that road, but I still think that he could bring something to the table for some NFL team.
Yeah, for sure. And I think the commercial with Nike was like extremely positive message. And like in those, and I think that's the thing that people were trying to say before, to do it off the field, and then they do it off the field, and then they're still getting criticism for it.
Yeah, you know, and I've seen so many detractors from his commercial, you know, the first night that it came out during the game. And, you know, to me, I have a six-year-old daughter.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to look at things through a child's eyes. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you were to watch that commercial and you take any negativity away from that, then I almost say shame on you, because there isn't really no political message that's in that commercial. It's just saying, you know, if you dream big and people tell you your dreams are crazy, they're not. There's nothing that's crazy. I mean, anything that you can imagine, you can do. And I showed that to my daughter. I said, hey, don't let anybody ever tell you that you can't do something. Like, yeah. There are people who told me that you'll never be a sportscaster. You yeah. cuss too much and you stutter.
Yeah.
I said, all right, you don't think so? I'm like, well, all I know how to do is play baseball, wait tables, and do this. So, I mean, it's baseball didn't work out, and you know, my feet are hurting. I'm tired of coming home smelling like rotisserie chicken from Bandera. So I better be able to get this at some point or another.
Gotcha. Actually, I thought maybe Colin Kaepernick would take the Tim Tebow route and go play minor league baseball.
I never really even thought about that, because Colin Kaepernick had a pretty solid arm. I said he was about 95 off the hill back in the day. So
yeah, I heard 98.
Go ahead.
I heard he threw 98 at one point.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's Patrick Mahomes style. I don't see why not. I mean, if he could pitch.
Yeah.
I mean, if he just loves sport, but I think right now he's
yeah.
fighting a different cause.
Yeah,
I think that's pretty much where his energy is channeled at. But, I mean, if he could play, but you have to find you have to get him one of those old school Oscar Gamble Yankees hats to fit over that hat, that hair he's got rocking out. But either way, man, you know what I'm saying? I just think the commercial, extremely positive. Like, I every time I see it, I stop and I watch it. It's great. Because, like I said, a lot of people said I would never be a sportscaster.
Yeah,
I
got
so,
it.
You know, but that was one of my dreams, and it's something I've, you know, fortunately I've been able to fulfill in my life, and you know, I feel blessed every day that I get to go out there and do what I do. Because sometimes people they come, they get in a bad mood, and they're upset, and it's like I always say, hey man, like our job's not rocket science. Like, I'm not laying bricks, I'm not running a jackhammer. And there's a lot of people who would love to do what I do, so I'm going to do my job and do it with a smile and treat everybody as I want to be treated. So that's all I can really do.
Yeah, for sure. Now, going into like television and like now with social media live streams, like where do you think all that stuff's going, say, in like the next like 5 years?
I mean, I don't know, because I mean, they've been saying that for so long. Like, the future of TV is online, and you know, I mean, you do see online, you know, outlets that they do, you know, generate some steam. But at the end of the day, TV is still TV. Like, the people that watch TV are going to watch TV. Like, I don't want to see highlights up on a phone. That's just me.
Yeah.
You know, I'd rather, can I get up to speed real quick? Yes. But is the full story told to me? No. Because chances are, you know, that you don't have fully produced highlight shows with where they go highlights into sound, into full screens, into on cams. And then when you see that, it's just a total package. I mean, that's what I really enjoy watching. I always have. And for people who say, like, oh, the traditional highlight show is dead, that couldn't be further from the truth, because, you know, game day highlights, we get great ratings each and every single Sunday. I feel like the highlights need to be packaged in a manner that someone wants to watch. You have to be entertaining, you have to be a storyteller, and you have to be different than everybody else. Because if it's the same as what they saw online, what's the point of watching?
I don't even, like, really even watch TV anymore. It's kind of weird, but, like, I still know what's, like, everything's going on just, like, from social media.
How old are you, Paul? Because I feel like you and I have been in correspondence, man, for at least 5 years now, since I was in Bristol.
So I'm 26.
Okay, because my nephew just graduated from NYU,
okay,
and he is about to be 22,
yeah,
and he says he doesn't watch TV,
yeah,
he doesn't go to the movies, and I'm like, what?
Yeah.
I mean, granted, Netflix and everything, that's, you know, all the developments and technology when it comes to movie streaming and everything, that's all well and good, but there's nothing like going to see a movie in a theater, like...
Yeah, no, I still go to the movies.
Yeah, I mean, there's something about it. I mean, do I see as many movies in theaters as I used to? No, but do I see all the kids' movies? Yeah, because I've got a six-year-old daughter, and we live like half a mile from a movie theater.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I couldn't imagine never going to see a movie ever again. Like, That's kind of weird. Just watching it on the phone or on your TV?
Yeah, no. But, yeah, even, like, when I was in college and my professor kept on talking about second screen, meaning, like, phone. And I was just like, I'm not watching stuff on my phone. And now, like, I'm watching stuff on my phone. I'm not watching, like, full. I don't watch full games and stuff on phone. But I'm saying, like, highlights and stuff, yeah. But not, if I'm watching a game, yeah, I don't. Well, I mean, I just don't have cable, too. So that's why I probably don't watch TV. But I still wouldn't.
Yeah.
Like, when I had cable, I would just put on, say, ESPN or Fox Sports 1 or NFL Network. And I would have it on, but I'd be on my computer doing something else.
Background noise.
Yeah, basically. So that's why it's kind of funny with the podcast things in general right now, because now I see why everyone's listening to podcasts, because everyone's always doing something or like driving to work or going to whatever, and they're just listening to it. So it's almost like everything's kind of going a little backward, because podcast is kind of like a radio.
It is. And, you know, I've been on podcasts. I've never done a podcast. I mean, I do, you know, the SiriusXM NFL radio, you know, Tuesday and Wednesday nights during the season, you know, the final drive. And, you know, I've been on podcasts, and, you know, Terrell Davis wants to do a podcast. We just haven't actually, you know, put the rubber to the road yet. So I'm interested to see, you know, once I dip my toes into that podcast water, what it's actually going to be like. So, you know, they're definitely fun, and they're different, and the wave of the future from what it looks like.
Yeah, it's crazy, because, like I said, I think it's, like, kind of backwards, but it's forward. I don't know.
Yeah.
So, knowing you played college baseball, and I know you're a huge baseball fan, is one of your goals to eventually work in baseball one day?
Well, I mean, this year, I mean, I know we follow each other on Twitter, but, you know, I'm sure you follow a whole bunch of people. I don't know how close attention you pay, but, you know, I got to work for the Dodgers this year.
Okay.
I got to do 25 games. I did half and half. I did half at the field, half in studio when I worked for Spectrum. When John Hartung, who does the studio shows, and Alana Rizzo, who's the Dodgers field reporter, whenever they had wanted days off, you know, I came out of the bullpen ready to roll, and I had a blast, man. You know, being, you know, that my roots are you know, centered in baseball, and for me, you know, it's, you know, I'm a Cubs fan. I'm a lifelong Cubs fan, man. You know, 2016 was, you know, November 2nd was one of the best days ever.
Yeah.
But the fact that since I've been living here, you know, I grew up playing ball with Jerry Harrison Jr. and Justin Harrison and Scott Harrison, you know, all the Harrison brothers back home in Chicago.
Yep.
And so when I first moved here to Los Angeles, I would always call Jerry, because he worked for the Dodgers in Spectrum.
Yep.
I'd, you know, say, Jerry, can you hook me and my daughter, or me and my wife and daughter up with some tickets for the game? And he always, never any questions asked. He'd always hook me up. So we've been going to Dodgers games since I first moved out here. And so my little girl just become like the biggest Dodger fan. I mean, you can do a picture flip, and she will tell you every player by name. They don't even need to have a Dodger hat on. You just show their faces, and she'll tell you their number, tell you what position they play. So for me, it's always been like to see her develop this love of baseball for the Dodgers. And she said that her favorite thing to do in the entire world is to go to a Dodgers game. She'd rather go to a Dodgers game than Chuck E. Cheese, than Six Flags, than Knott's Berry Farm, which to me, that's just fine. Because anytime I ever have a question, is there anything she wants to do, let's go to the Dodgers game. Let's go check it out. So being the fact that I always was going to those games for the last 4 years, I always had kind of a, you know, a little bit of a rooting interest in the Dodgers, unless they played the Cubs.
Yeah.
And then I was cheering for my Cubs. But this year, being able to work for the Dodgers and be able to go to the games, be in the clubhouse. You know, like I said, my first day working with the Dodgers this year, I had to do a shadow shift.
Mm-hmm.
And it was Jackie Robinson Day.
Yeah.
And I covered Dave Roberts when he worked in Boston, when I worked at Nesson. And Dave saw me, and he came up and he said, "Hey, Cole, man, you know, it's great to have you here, especially on a day like today." And for me, being a guy that had baseball pretty much shaped and molded my entire career,
mm-hmm.
and to know that I wouldn't be at this point in my life had it not been for the game of baseball, whether or not I still am entrenched in the game, which at that point I clearly was not. But for the only African-American manager in baseball to, you know, extend that olive branch to me and say, "Hey, it's really big that you're here, especially on a day like today." And it's like, for me, being in Dodger Stadium, although Jackie Robinson never played in Dodger Stadium, to be an African-American male working for the Dodgers in a baseball capacity, that was pretty big for me. Like, you know, it took me a minute. I was like, wow, like, this is a pretty neat experience. And especially for my dad, like, my dad's almost 75 years old. And, you know, that was kind of a neat thing for him, just to know that, okay, the team that pretty much changed America and how America thinks. Well, you know, my son gets to work for them for a few games this year, and for me that was super cool. And just to see how they've been, the ups and downs they've been going through this year, I feel like I find myself checking in on the Dodgers more than I do the Cubs. You know, which I feel like it's just driving around LA. I've got so many Cubs hats. I've got at least 15 Cubs hats, and like right now they're all dusty. Yeah. I mean, it wouldn't look great if I work for the Dodgers and I'm riding around Los Angeles wearing my Cubs hat. But don't worry, Cubs hats, you'll be broken out soon enough.
For sure. So actually, that was my next question. How do you think the Cubs are going to do this playoff? So, and I'll ask, how do you think the Dodgers are going to do?
You know, I hope we're on a collision course for another Cubs-Dodgers NLCS. Yeah. I mean, I just don't know if that's how it's going to go down. But I think if both teams get hot at the right time, I think that's where we could be. And I'd love to see it, because, you know, I just love to take my little one to the World Series. Because after the Cubs won in 2016, I told her, like, as I'm standing, there's a picture. My mom took a picture of us. I'm holding her, standing in front of the TV. Of course, my back is to my mom because I didn't want, my eyes were sweating a little bit after the Cubs won. But so I didn't need that to be captured on film at all. So I told my daughter, I said, don't worry, the Dodgers will win next year. And then sure enough, seven games, they made Daddy out to be a liar. So hopefully this year they can get it done. I don't know if they have the pitching, but maybe, you know, it's all about timing. Guys come together at the right time. Like, I don't know if you saw Walker Buehler last night, but that cat, zero earned, eight innings, was out there carving on the St. Louis Cardinals. And right now they're in a tie with St. Louis for that second wild card spot. They're only a half a game off the Rockies. So we'll see, man. Like I said, I was talking with Ned Coletti. I work with Ned Coletti, former GM of the Dodgers, and he's a Chicago guy as well. And I told him, I said, man, it's so hard right now to, you know, to not cheer for the Dodgers when the Cubs are my team. And Ned said, you know what? It's all right, man. It's like, he's a Cubs guy. He used to work for the Cubs. And he said, it's hard to separate teams that you work for professionally and have a vested interest in, as opposed to teams that you grew up cheering for. And you'll still cheer for the teams that you grew up cheering for, but you'll also cheer for that squad that you feel like you have a fingerprint on. And I feel like for this year, you know, whether or not I work for the Dodgers next year or whatever it may be, and hopefully that I'll still be able to do that in some capacity, but I feel like I have some kind of fingerprints on this team. Like, if I walk into the Dodgers clubhouse, like, Matt Kemp and Justin Turner will say, what's up? You know, Rich Hill's locker's right when you get there. You know, he'll give you a head nod. If I walk into the Cubs locker room, Joe Madden and them are asking if they're calling for security. Like, who is this kid, man? Get him out of here. So it's a little bit different when you're able to be in touch with a team like that.
Yeah, for sure. I know you talked about, it's the same thing with me. If somebody wears my gear or I meet them or something, then I'm going to root for them, you know?
Absolutely. And then, makes sense.
Yeah, and then actually, even though I hate to say it, I think the Astros still got the best chance right now.
They're good, man. No, they're
I think their team chemistry is just, like, unreal.
Their home run celebration where they all look one way and then all of a sudden they turn around real fast to the camera, it's next level. And I'm an Alex Bregman guy, man, because, you know, I covered LSU. Yeah. You know, when he was at LSU, he was Alex Freshman, you know. That was his nickname. And he was the man from the very beginning, man. And I mean, he's the first third baseman in the history of baseball with 30 home runs and 50 doubles.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, man. Those are dirty numbers, man. Alex Bregman is a force. I mean, so you have all these undersized guys on Houston, too, that just, I mean, they hit yaks. I mean, you got Altuve leads the league in hitting, you know, every single year, it seems like. And, I mean, the guy is, I mean, I haven't been the same size as Jose Altuve since the mid-80s. I mean, you know, that guy, I mean, he's unbelievable. You never see him. If you never knew who he was and he walked into a bar and he's like, yeah, man, like, I can hit X amount of home runs and hit over 300 every single year, lead the league in hitting. You'd be like, in what league? What league are you talking about? You playing with Ricky Vaughn in the California Penal League? Like, I don't think so. But, I mean, like I said, these guys, they put up tremendous numbers. A.J. Hinch has done a great job with that squad. So we'll see how it all works out, man. I mean, it's going to be – like, if we can get even a portion of the World Series to be like it has been the last 2 years, then we're all winners.
Yeah, for sure. What's your favorite sports movie, and what's your favorite baseball sports movie?
Man, that's kind of the first movie I ever saw in the theater, ever, as a kid, was The Natural.
Okay.
So I kind of have a soft spot for that, and aside from, like, animated movies, the first real movie that my daughter saw, it wasn't at a theater, but it was at Dodger Stadium when we first moved here, the first Dodger game that her and I went to by ourselves. It was movie night at Dodger Stadium, and of all movies, what did they play? The Natural. Wow. So, and at that point, she was like, I'm thinking not even three? Yeah. And I have pictures of her, and she lasted like 45 minutes. So for her, for a 3-year-old to sit, like, The Natural's not really a kid-friendly movie.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like, it's not inappropriate by any stretch of the imagination. Yeah. But most 3-year-olds aren't going to be all jacked up to see Robert Redford and Kelly McGillis and Kim Basinger, you know, get into it, and the dad from Christmas Story. Yeah. But, yeah. You know, she stayed for 45 minutes, and that movie holds kind of a special place because, you know, that's when the switch really flipped for me as a kid, when I really realized, like, hey, I kind of dig this baseball thing. And when I said, had it not been for baseball, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. And, you know, covering the NFL, like, that's exactly where I want to be. And it's because it's not necessarily it is the sports. I love the NFL, and I feel like it's the condensation of it. It's the fact that, you know, it's Sunday, everyone's locked in, as opposed to there's a game every single day, and it's more of a, like, football's a sprint. Baseball's a marathon. Damn. And, you know, I feel like whether or not I was, you know, the way I used to run back in the day, I wasn't really a great distance runner, but I can get after it for running the 60. So yeah. I enjoy the sprint as opposed to the marathon. I like just sprinklings of the marathon. So
gotcha. Jumping back into football, do you have any Super Bowl predictions? I know it's super early.
I'll tell you what, man. My Super Bowl prediction, I mean, it is super early, but, you know, I picked the Saints out of the NFC, and their defense looks about non-existent. I mean, they look like a bunch of parked cars out there, and people just running around them. So I don't know if the Saints are going to be the NFC pick. Maybe I'll go with the Vikings. Okay, I'll pick two. My first one I picked was Patriots-Saints.
Okay.
My alternate one, and this might be a curveball. You might be with me on this one. You might not be. But I'm going to go with Vikings-Chiefs.
Okay, that's a bold one right there.
It's bold, man, but I tell you what. I used to be Patrick Mahomes. I was his local sportscaster.
Gotcha.
At KETK, Channel 56 in Tyler, Texas, when he went to White House.
There you go.
And I'm a fan of that kid, man. He came into to NFL Network. I mean, the fact that he had a 97-mile-an-hour fastball and chose football.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a bold decision, because that is free money on the table before any injuries ever occur. And hopefully his career goes injury-free 100%. But, I mean, if you can say, hey, I can get this money right now to play baseball and just throw. I don't have to – no one's going to hit me at all. No one's going to hit me while I'm throwing.
Yeah.
And, you know, the fact that, you know, if your dad played in the league, it makes it that much easier for you to succeed. Because there's always going to be a scout or somebody that says, well, he's got this potential. Like, yeah, his dad did it, maybe he can too. And for him to pass on that, to go play football at Texas Tech, and it's, and not to take anything away from Texas Tech, but Texas Tech is not Texas or LSU or Miami, or, you know, I don't know if Miami's the same Miami as they once were, however, or Alabama, you know what I'm saying, though?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Texas Tech is not the top flight, even though it's a top flight program. You know, if you're going to get, you know, X amount of dollars that, you know, looks close to seven figures to play baseball or play football in Lubbock, Texas, I think a lot of cats would choose baseball, especially when you have a golden arm like that. But Patrick Mahomes knew what his fate was, and I think he knows that he's the next best thing at the quarterback position. I'm riding with him, man. I believe in him. I like this kid.
Yeah, for sure. And I don't know if he got drafted, because I know, like, obviously, usually they just draft anybody just because there's 50 rounds. But I know Kyler Murphy just took the money, but he's still playing at Oklahoma.
Oh, a lot of guys do that. Yeah. Ricky Williams in the Phillies financed his whole collegiate career at the University of Texas. So, you know, a lot of guys, he got drafted, took the money, and then played baseball and underperformed on the diamond, and then they paid for him to win a Heisman Trophy and then run it up against, you know, Oklahoma and everybody else. So, you know, I don't fault any of those guys that want to do that. You know, Brandon Wheaton played baseball before he played football. So, you know, who knows? You know, maybe we'll see some guys, you know, make that switch. But for right now, Patrick Mahomes, I mean, he's the next best thing going to Kansas City. And I think that they, with all those offensive weapons, I mean, Kareem Hunt and Travis Kelce were innocent bystanders on Sunday. Tyreek Hill was just a one-man wrecking crew.
Yeah.
And I think when they're all on the same page, that Kansas City team is going to be nice, man.
I really
believe that.
For sure. And you can't forget about Sammy Watkins. Maybe he'll resurrect his career over there.
Exactly. And he's a guy, he's the unforgotten cat that, I mean, everyone isn't really paying attention to the fact, like, oh, he's not on the Rams anymore. Okay, let's see. Maybe the Rams could still use him. Like, who knows? I mean, the Rams look good, too. So, like, that's the best part of the first 4 weeks of the season. Like, nobody knows who's who.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I mean, Cincinnati, nobody thought, oh, yeah, the Ravens are going to come out and smack Cincinnati on Thursday night. Because, I mean, what they did to the Bills. But the Bills are really, really bad. The Bills took care of a really bad team. The Bengals, I guess, better than what we thought.
Yeah, Bengals are always, like, there. They just never win in the playoffs.
It's almost that Dennis Green. Like, the Bengals, they are who we thought they were. And we don't want the Hawks.
Yeah, that's who they are.
Rest in peace, Denny Green.
And last question, could you give me any funny stories that happened, like, on air or anything during work hours?
Well, when I first started doing NFL HQ, that was the forerunner to Good Morning Football. It was TD, I think LeVar Arrington, and maybe Michael Fabiano were on, or maybe Daniel Jeremiah. Mm-hmm. And we hit the top of an hour. And I just started. I'd been at the network for about 2.5 months. I'd been working on that show for maybe a week and a half. And I think it was a Monday show because I feel like we were going through highlights. And I remember I hear an alarm go off, and it sounded like the same. I know TD has a Samsung as well. So on live TV, I mean, what do you do? There's an alarm going off full bore. So I said to Mike, I'm like, look at this guy. At that point, he was just a Hall of Fame nominee. Hadn't gotten that gold jacket yet. I'm like, look at this guy, Hall of Fame nominee, doesn't know how to turn his alarm off. You know, just trying to play it off on live television. And he's like, that ain't my fault, man, that's yours.
Damn.
And I was like, So I just kind of hit the mute button and just kept it moving. And, you know, it's funny how things, and at one point in your career, if that would have happened to me, like on live TV in San Angelo, Texas, I probably would have froze and we would have had to go to commercial, but you know, you get a few extra hours under your belt, and you know, you're working with a great bunch of guys that you can all laugh everything off and keep it moving. You know, that's just pretty much where it was.
Gotcha. Actually, I got one more. I forgot. What advice would you give somebody that wants to be on air?
I'd say get your work in. I mean, watch your games, get your work in, and never turn work down. Yeah. Like that's what I do. It's like, you know, it's to a point where, you know, when I first started, before I even was doing radio, I used to always do radio with the guys that cover Arkansas State, because I used to be the Sun Belt guy at ESPN, so I used to do the Sun Belt conference meetings every year, and they have a radio show that's in Jonesboro, Arkansas, and these guys, you know, they welcomed me on with open arms, man. They said, we'd like you to come on every week. So for 2 years plus, I'd go on there every week and do radio for free.
Yeah.
And my wife's like, why are you doing radio for free? I'm like, I'm just trying to sharpen up my radio skills, because if you don't do it, you're not going to get any better at it. And, you know, that was one thing I always took to heart. You know, eventually when I got to Fox, you know, I was lucky enough to have my own show on Sundays with Bill Ryder, who works on CBS radio now. And, you know, now I have my own radio show on Sirius XM every Tuesday and Wednesday nights. You know, Tuesday's 9 o'clock Eastern time, and on Wednesday's 8 o'clock Eastern time. So, you know, it's like I said, always work. You know, it's because at the end of the day, it's not really work. It's just putting in your time.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. I mean, if you can't enjoy going to cover a sporting event, whether it be at the high school level or the professional level, I mean, if you feel that you have what it takes, those high school games are going to turn into college games, which will then turn into professional games, and then you'll be exactly where you wanted to be. Like some of the kids that get antsy and they're like, "Well, I have to go here or here." I understand that to a certain degree, but there's nothing worse than being put in a situation that you're not ready for yet. Like we've seen people before that are not ready. Like you know, not to throw any shade, but remember the Sergio Dip guy?
No.
Well, search and go Google when you're done. He was the guy. He's a foreign language anchor, but they threw him on a game that he was not ready for. Like, he just didn't know what he was saying out there. And it's like, be careful what you wish for, because sometimes it's not always the right scenario. So I feel for me, like, the general progression I took, you know, one step to the next, and got progressively bigger, that was perfect. Because, you know, if I would have been thrown in a major market or something like that, you know, right out of school, I wasn't ready. I would have been out there stumbling and bumbling, and people would have said, like, this guy's a bozo. No one, and I never would have got a job again. So, you know, just do your work. Don't turn any work down, and just stay humble. Like, treat people how you want to be treated. And, you know, don't be that guy who people say, oh, he's so hard to work with. Like, just be cool with everybody. At the end of the day, man, like, if you're a sports anchor and then you made your way into this business, we've got a great job. Yeah. You know, there's people every day that would love to have our jobs. Just always think about that and never forget it. Because who gets to go to, like, I get to go to work on Sunday. I sit in a theater, essentially, with leather reclining seats at NFL Network, and they cater food to us, and we get to watch games, and then I have to go put makeup and a suit on and go talk about it for an hour. Like, how can you be in a bad mood? Yeah. Like, I love my job, and I love what I do, and I try to bring a positive energy to work every day, and then hopefully everybody realizes that, and I think it just makes it a better work environment. And when kids realize coming out of school, no matter where you get, no matter what level you get to, just be cool, man. Just be cool with people. That's all I try to say.
Yeah, for sure. It's just like the journey through the minor league system.
Absolutely. You know, like I said, you and I have been on Twitter, we've been in corresponding with each other for at least 5-6 years, man. It's, you know, like, it was my pleasure to come on here with you today, like, any time. You know, like I said, I'm not saying that there's people that maybe would join you or maybe wouldn't, but for what would be the reason not to? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, you know what I'm saying? You could be my boss one day. I mean, you could be an executive at wherever. I mean, you could be, you know, the next president of NFL Network. Who knows? But that's not the reason we're cool.
Yeah.
We're just cool because there's no reason for us not to be.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
So that's my piece of advice. Just to tell the kids coming out of school to stay centered, stay focused and balanced, man, and treat people how you want to be treated, man.
I definitely appreciate you coming on the show, and want to tell the people where they can find you on social media.
I'm at Cole Wright NFL. That's pretty much it. All I have is Twitter. If it wasn't for this 2018 and everything how it is, I just have a house phone with no answer machine. But you can't do that anymore. But that's me. I'm the old school guy. I'm the guy when everyone's sitting there, you know, typing in their phone and in their tablet, I have a piece of pen and paper. You know, old school. So that's just how I like to operate.
You ever going to create an Instagram or not?
No. Negative. I'm a 40-year-old married dude, man. I don't need that in my life. There's no reason for that. Like, I feel like all the pictures I would ever even put out there for public consumption, like I do the same. I put the same pictures out on Twitter. Like, so I don't even get the Instagram concept. I really don't. So, like, I feel like you can do the same thing on Twitter.
What about like NFL Network? Do they ask you guys to make social media pages or no?
Well, since I already have a Twitter, I mean, like, a Twitter. I mean, you sound like an old guy. I've already got me a Twitter. But no, it's like we've had some, like, one of our social media managers. She sent me an email about, I don't know, Instagram Live or Instagram TV, and she's like, this would be great before shows. And I was like, I don't even have Instagram. She's like, what?
I think you should get Instagram.
Even Dan Haley the other day was talking about something, and he's like, you don't have Instagram? And I'm like, no, I don't have Instagram. Like, I don't know, like, I just feel like, and then all the people, like, say before a show, like, you know, people that they tweet out or they Instagram out, like, hey, everybody, we're in studio, we're about to get this thing going, like, I'm getting ready for my show, like, I'm making sure that my highlights are in order, like, I don't know what those people are doing, like, maybe they're just better than me, like, where they have all this extra time to show everybody what they're about to do, even though they're about to show everybody what they do, like, on TV, like, it's like getting an appetizer before an appetizer.
Yeah, behind the scenes stuff.
It's like, let me have some cheese and crackers before we deliver my calamari. Like, that's a little too much. So I don't know. I'm just an old guy at heart, man. Like, I think Twitter is good for me, and that's where I'm going to be at.
All right. Well, I appreciate you coming on, and good luck in the future.
Hey, anytime, Paul. Anytime you need me, man. Just let me know.
All right.
No doubt.